Recruiting, the backbone of your direct selling business. What do the Girl Scouts, NBA teams, the military, Fortune 500 companies, and colleges all have in common with direct selling? Well, recruiting. Recruiting is the lifeblood of every organization. Recruiting is how organizations grow and expand their purpose and, in case of businesses, grow their profits. You see, the recruiting is especially important in direct selling because, unlike retail stores where customers come to them, direct sellers must go directly to customers. And as we know, the more customers and business partners you recruit, the more stable and profitable your business becomes. Putting people through the process. Many direct sellers confuse the words prospecting, recruiting, and sponsoring. They think they're synonyms, but they're not. Actually, there are three different stages in building a business, in building your business. So the first stage is prospecting. This is the qualifying phase when you talk to people, asking them questions to discover their needs and wants and to determine the best way to share your product and or your opportunity. When you prospect for business builders, you're looking for people who are looking. Your goal is to identify individuals who are dissatisfied with their current jobs and careers and are open to owning their home-based business. Stage 2, recruiting. See, in this stage, you want to make your presentation and ask your prospect to join your business. Your goal is to move the prospect from "I'm interested" to "I'm in" by having them sign the paperwork and make a commitment of working the business. Stage 3 is sponsoring. In this final phase, you begin mentoring your new recruit, plugging them into your support system and teaching them how to work the business and helping them to set appointments and achieve the success that they're looking for. In the next training module, we'll be able to discuss that a lot more in detail with you. So we'll just put that on hold for now. A good analogy for the recruiting process in direct sales can be found in college sports programs. Colleges hire full-time scouts and recruiters to visit schools and youth leagues to search for talent. They start by watching prospects perform, evaluating their skills, and interviewing them to determine which ones of them would be good fits for their programs. If the recruiter thinks the youngster would be an asset to their team, he will move to the recruiting stage, inviting the prospect to visit the campus and meet the coaches and team leaders, and at the end ask them to sign a letter of commitment. Once the prospect signs the paperwork and commits to the school, then they enter the sponsoring stage. That's where they start learning the coach's system, receive intensive training, and are mentored by the coaches and seasoned player to help them achieve their fullest potential. Instead of prospecting for great athletes, direct selling professionals prospect for retail customers and for potential business builders by seeking out people who are open-minded, teachable, and are looking to move in their lives. The ideal prospects can be described as dissatisfied successful, that is, leaders or self-starters who have succeeded in a chosen field but are disenchanted and open to exploring further opportunities. A lot of time we also follow the NCT rule. The NCT rule talks about never can tell. So although many times good prospects come from successful individuals that are professionals in a specific field, yet many times individuals never can tell how good they can be in a specific business unless we give them an opportunity, unless we show them the opportunity. You see, our responsibility is to share the opportunity with people, but it's up to them to decide if they'd like to join that opportunity. Prospecting. There are two categories of prospects you can share your products and opportunities with. People you already know and people that you haven't known yet. The people that you know, we call that your warm market. Your warm market consists of friends, family, co-workers, and acquaintances, plus people who know you, such as your children's teachers or members of organizations you belong to, and different other networking groups. Right now, let's concentrate on prospecting people you don't know, but come in contact with every single day. Could be sales clerks, people in lines and at banks, people you often see at shopping or local grocery stores, people you are introduced to at a party or a business function, and so forth and so on. One of the biggest benefits of direct selling is that some of your best friends and most productive members of your team will be people that you would have never known before getting into this business. So the more people you meet and share your products and opportunity with, the better your odds of building a solid, self-sustainable business. Baby steps, not bombs away. When you're contacting new people, the last thing you want to do is blow them out of the water by forcing your opportunity down their throat too soon. You don't want to, for example, corner a stranger in a frozen section in the store and say, "Hey, do you want to get rich quick?" That wouldn't be advisable. Your goal with a new contact is to strike up a conversation, make a connection, and begin building a common bond and trust with that person. Towards the end of the conversation, ask for a business card or the phone number and tell them that I'll get back to you within a few days and set up an appointment. Follow up and follow through. Okay, so you've met your new prospects over the weekend. They're bright, easy to talk with, energetic and friendly. Perfect prospect for your business. You remember to get their phone number, and as you were parting, you told them that you're going to give them a call in the next few days. What you do next will separate the amateurs from the pros. The amateurs fall victim of the phonophobia. This is where they'll make every single excuse why not to call their prospects. So then 2 days go by, 2 weeks, and possibly even 2 months. Then the amateurs realize that it might be too late to call some of these promising prospects, and as a result, they fall through the cracks. See, fear of rejection and failure to follow up are the two biggest reasons why people fail in direct selling. Direct selling professionals master the art of using the phone to contact prospects and set appointments to learn about our products and opportunity, making small talk. On the surface, small talk is just chit-chat about everyday matters. But for direct sellers, small talk actually provides a big window to a prospect's character and personality. See, if you're alert, you can learn a lot about a person in a 2-minute conversation. Things like, does the prospect make eye contact with me? Are they positive and uplifting? Or are they negative and critical? That energy is easily noticeable. Do they have enthusiasm and variety in their voice? Or do they have a quick laugh and inviting smile? Are they sarcastic or sincere? See, is this someone that you'd want to recruit or run away from? At the end, if you recruit somebody, you're going to spend time with them, so you might as well make sure that you have individuals and people that you'd really enjoy spending time with. In a brief conversation with a prospect, you can get these and many more questions answered. So you don't think you're good at small talk because you don't know what to say to people? Well, then use the simple acronym called FORM to break the ice. F stands for family, O stands for occupation, R recreation, and M stands for money. So for example, about occupation, you might ask somebody, what do they do for a living? So after they respond, you may say, great, I bet you love that, don't you? Now, most of the time, this question opens a floodgate to their innermost feelings about their job, such as, my boss is a beep, just kidding, or I'm underpaid and underappreciated. See, the power of asking questions. Ever notice that the best communicators ask lots of questions? See, good questions prompt prospects to open up and own the answers you're seeking from them. If you say it, they doubt it. But if they say it, it is true because they have said that themselves. Lots of research shows that people value more what they conclude than what they are told by others. So opening phrases, things like, wouldn't you agree that, and keep going? Isn't it true that? Can you see how? Doesn't that make sense? So ways that you can actually get them to agree with you towards the ending of the phrases is you can just say something at the end, say, wouldn't you agree? Or isn't that, isn't that right? Or don't you think so? For example, after talking with new prospects, you may want to mention that people don't socialize as much as they used to. Rather than making a statement, a more effective way is to phrase it in a question. So saying things like, Janice, it seems to me that people don't talk face to face as much as they used to, and that's not good for families or neighbors. Wouldn't you agree? You see, when you're making a question, it becomes more engaging and interactive, and Janice is likely to give you the right answer you're looking for. So most likely, Janice will agree with you, and that opens the door for you to say, well, what do you say if we can show you how many people are breaking that habit and we get together for a coffee next week. Shall I give you a call? When is it best? When is the best time for me to reach you? Morning, afternoons, or evenings? Alan Pease, author of the bestseller, Questions Are the Answers, says, when you're interesting, your prospect will be interested. And the best way to appear interesting is to ask questions that lead the prospect to self-discovery and personal insight. Recruiting. Okay, you just met a prospect. You followed up and agreed to meet for a coffee after dropping off the kids at school. You'd love to recruit them into your business. So how do you approach them first? Do you talk about the product? We talk about the opportunity. The answer, of course, is it depends. If your prospect revealed in a previous conversation that she was thinking about going back to work, but didn't really want a 9-to-5 job, then he or she just opened the door for you to talk about the opportunity, the power of a part-time, that is, how to earn extra money and help them make a car payment, save money for children's education, or simply working a 10-hour week to help them achieve their goals. Or for the more ambitious people, how is it that they can turn a part-time work opportunity into a full-time income or a home-based career? If, on the other hand, you represent a life-altering product that delivers immediate results by helping prospects lose weight, look younger, or feel more energetic, then lead with the product. Become a product of the product. Whether you're a full-time, fast-track business builder with a network marketing company, or a part-timer retailing products to friends and family, you still have to become a product of the product, a devoted user and knowledgeable promoter of your product line. You see, the more you use and fall in love with your product, the easier it is for you to show your enthusiasm. We know that enthusiasm is contagious. You know what they say, the last four words of enthusiasm stands, you know, are IMSM, stands for I am sold myself. And you get there by using and experiencing the benefits of your products. So when you transfer enthusiasm, a sale actually happens. You see, if you owned a couple of dozen Ford dealerships, for example, you wouldn't be driving into work with a Mercedes, would you? Of course not. You see, Warren Buffett, the world's richest man, prefers the taste of Pepsi, but he drinks 5 Cokes a day. Why? Because he owns 8% of Coke's stock. So that is being the product of the product. Presenting the plan. Whether you lead with the product or the opportunity, at some point in time, you'll want to offer your prospect the opportunity to join the business. If you're brand new to the business, your sponsor will likely suggest a 2-on-1 presentation where you provide the contact while your more experienced sponsor presents the opportunity. Eventually, you'll have to learn how to take prospects through the process yourself and return the favor to your recruits. People are pressed for time these days, so keep your presentations short and powerful. Talk about the benefits of the products rather than the features and stay away from technical explanations. Keep in mind the old saying, facts tell while feelings sell. If a prospect keeps pushing for technical information about your product or some specific areas, just say, you know what, we can look into that if you want. But, you know, most people don't know how aspirin works anyway. What they do know is that it does relieve their pain. It's just a way of diverting that objection. See, people respond warmly to stories, so learn your company's story and practice it until you can deliver a 30 to 90 second version of it. Same for your product, the founder of the company, your upline, and the reason why you got in business. So things like, for example, the reason why I decided to join the business because I was not finding time to spend with my loved ones. I was so depressed going to work every single day, not excited about why I'm there. So I decided to give that a try. And here I am, you know, a few months, few weeks, few years later, I'm so lucky that I did decide to give that one opportunity a try. The foremost question in every prospect's mind is, what's in it for me? So make sure you continuously remind your prospects what the product and the opportunity will do to improve their lives. Answering questions and handling objections. You want to make your presentation in person, so only use the phone to set an appointment. Your prospects will have lots of questions and likely a few objections, especially to the opportunity. See, people don't always say what they mean, and they don't always mean what they say. So when a prospect says no to the opportunity, their answers may be covered up for a deeper conflict. A no is the consequence of one of four things. Number one is fear of failure. That's what holds most people back. Number two is the fear of rejection. Nobody wants to be ridiculed by friends or family. Number three is a low self-image or self-esteem. They don't think they can do it. And number four is any misconceptions about the business based on ignorance. There's nothing you can do or say to change the mind of a totally negative prospect. So the best thing to do is change the prospect. Ignorance, on the other hand, isn't a sin. It's just lack of knowledge. See, us as direct sellers, we get paid to educate people. So the better you are at answering questions and overcoming objections, the more successful you will become. Here's a tip on handling sincere objections to the opportunity. Number one is listen carefully and avoid any interruptions. Number two is repeat the objection so that you're clear you understand it. So say something like, if I understand you correctly, are you saying that blah, blah, blah? Number three, use the feel, felt, found method to answering objection, saying something like, I know exactly how you feel, Judy, because I felt the same way until I found out about blah, blah, blah. So we can show you how that works in just a few seconds. After hearing all the prospect's objections, isolate the main objection, answer it, and then ask for a decision. So here's an example of handling a main objection of someone who told you that their biggest concern might be their time. Frank, you told me that your biggest concern is lack of time, right? I appreciate that because I felt the same way when I was looking at the business. Just a question. If lack of time wasn't the issue, is there any other reason why you wouldn't get started right now? I like that question because if the prospect has a different reason, it will then come out. So this will clarify the main objection to overcome. If this is the only concern, then you can say, I totally understand. Just that I'm clear, just want to ask you a quick question. Where will you be in the next 2 to 3 years if you don't make the time right now? And let them answer. And then say, what would it mean to you if you're able to achieve your goals and dreams faster? Now, notice these questions. They make your prospects tell you the benefits instead of you shoving it down their throat. And that is how they get to convince themselves. Get your prospects dreaming again. Very few people love what they do, so there are lots of dissatisfied successfuls desperate for an opportunity to own their lives by owning their own business. Sadly, they have deferred their dreams in exchange for a steady paycheck. One of the ways to influence people is to have them dream again, to think about what is it that they would want to achieve. So you could ask several questions, say something like, may I ask you a question, Judy? If time wasn't an issue for you, what would you be doing with your life? Or something like, can you get everything out of life by doing what you're currently doing? Or things like, where would you be in the next 2 to 3 years if you don't change what you're currently doing? Or what would it mean if you can schedule your work around your life instead of your life around your work? Another question would be, wouldn't it be great if you can help others get more time with their loved ones and earn a decent living in the process? See, all these questions help the client or help the potential prospects get excited about, build excitement around the opportunity that you're offering them. And that's how you're going to be persuading them to make their own decisions. That's it for this lesson. See you on the next lesson.